Just a few quick announcements before we get started. First of all, for this food pounding, I think that's what Pastor Raymond called it, to help stock the cupboards for whenever the Cole family gets here. We ask that the food needs to come here to the church, not to the parsonage. And we also ask that if you can, please bring non-perishables. If you bring perishables, they're going to end up at Pastor Raymond's house so that he can feed them while they're at his house. So with that being said, also, next Sunday we will be doing a love offering for them, just to help them kind of recuperate the expenses of driving all the way from Idaho. And then on the 26th of June, I believe it'll be immediately after the service. Someone can correct me if I'm wrong, but we will be having a, oh, the 23rd. Okay, he told me wrong.
What did I tell you?
The 26th. That, thank you, Becky. Okay, not the 26th. It's on the 23rd. I would have realized that if I would have actually looked at the calendar, but we will be having a celebration for them after the service to just make them feel welcomed into our church family. Other than that, there will be youth group tonight from 6 to 8 o'clock. And speaking of, I guess, both the youth and the kids, both kids camp and teen camp are coming up this month. Teen camp is the 24th through, I think, the 30th or something. I don't know, the last week of June. And kids camp is the week prior to that. So just be in prayer for, everyone that's in charge of that, everyone that's going, and all the volunteers that, take the time off of work or whatever to be able to go and help these kids experience Jesus. And finally, every Tuesday is our community prayer meeting. For the month of June, it will be held at the Methodist Church. Is there only one Methodist church in Monongahela?
There's only one Methodist church.
Okay, so it's the Methodist church in Monongahela. So that's where it is. And with that being said, that's all I got.
Thank you.
amazing things. And sometimes in our lives, we don't see the amazing things that God is doing. And I want to tell you, yesterday was an amazing day. Yesterday was team day, and I have to tell you, this weekend coming up is District Assembly, Friday and Saturday, and yesterday was team day, in which our missions, our Christian education, and our youth have their own little conventions and whatever. And I love meetings so much. I mean, it's the best thing in my life to have a meeting. You know, I just love sitting down and talking and listening to people report and all this stuff, and you're sitting there going, okay. And stuff. But let me tell you, yesterday was exciting because we had 15 people participate from our church in Team Day. And in the 24 years that I have been here, that is the most people that have participated in one event on the district in the 24 years that I've been here. And that is excellent that we were able to now get excitement to be part of some of the gatherings of our Nazarenes and listen to missionaries and listen to what's going on our district and some of the, and really when I sat in some of the little conventions, I can't go to all three of them, but I was in the NDI, Nazarene Discipleship International, that little meeting. They're talking about kids camp, and they're talking about all the things they want to do with children and everything. And I'm like, I hope they don't understand that we have a children's pastor on her way. And they can't ask her to do anything for a good year or so until she gets used to the community and everything here. But speaking of that, the other exciting thing is we now know that our youth minister is in Wyoming. Huh? Oh, children's minister. Yeah, is it? Yeah. Yeah. Why are you in Wyoming? She and her family are in Wyoming as of last night. They will be leaving. They probably have already left Wyoming or left where they're staying in Wyoming and moving on to the next stop. They had a little change in plans. They did not leave on Thursday. They did not leave on Friday like they had planned. They left Saturday, so they will not be getting into the Pennsylvania Monongahela area until Tuesday. So, but the fact is we are all excited that they finally left Idaho, and they are trekking their way this way. So, please keep them in prayer. It is a long trip. It is a long travel. It's a 4-day travel for them. And yesterday was probably exciting. Yesterday was probably exciting for them. Today is probably okay. Tomorrow's like, I don't want to do this again. And Tuesday is probably, get me out of this car now. So keep them in prayer. But God is alive. He is doing some great things in our church. And we have to just thank God and just be thankful for the privilege of all the great things that are happening in our church. So with that said,
the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in this holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God, their Savior. Such is the generation who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. Dear Lord, I thank you I thank you for being a King of Glory. I thank you that in all your glory, you still loved us enough that you sent your son to pay for our mistakes. I ask that you touch this service, allow your spirit to flow through everyone that's walked in these doors today, and help us all to not leave the same way we came in. And just help us to have a wonderful day worshiping you. In your name we pray, amen. Please stand and join in singing.
Please stand and recite together the creed that unites all Christians everywhere. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered unto Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Find his mercy.
I didn't tell you another God amazing story that happened this week. Ari graduated this week, and that is an amazing thing, and we want to congratulate her and celebrate her, because you know, you go to school for 18 years and then you're like faced with, oh no, I got to become a productive member in society. What now? So we're very proud of her and very happy for this accomplishment in her life. Speaking of graduations, Raymond does graduate on Tuesday at 7 o'clock at the Hillcrest Christian Academy in the gymnasium. It's up on Bethel Church Road. You can look it up and find it if you want to attend. Everybody is welcome. We are going to save a big section just for the Hillcrest or the Nazarenes, so that they all know. I'm just kidding, but anyways, please come. You're more than welcome to come. There's no assigned seating or anything, and you can sit in the back, and that'll be perfectly fine. That is where the Nazarene assigned seating is. We have like the back three rows assigned for us. So anyways, but you're more than welcome to come Tuesday at 7 o'clock p.m. at the Hillcrest Christian Academy in the gymnasium. And it's an exciting time. And this is my last one. And then in August, I'm an empty nester. And I don't know who Nestor is, but he's empty. And it's going to be a new thing to learn about life and you know what we're going to do. Tanya and I are going to be spending time together. Pray for us. It's going to be a major. It's going to be a major strain on our relationship that she has to now put up with me. Anyway, but it's an exciting time. This morning we're going to pray for our associate pastor, our children's minister, who is coming in and should be here shortly. So it is great. This is some good times within our church, and we need to pray that the Holy Spirit will continue to move. If you'd like to come forward at this time and kneel at the altar to be anointed or to pray, you are more than welcome to come. You can come now, and one of our staff members will anoint you. Let's spend some time talking to God this morning and letting God talk to us. Lord, this morning right now, we ask for a special grace upon the Cole family, upon their little children. This is some exciting times for them as they take a step in faith to fulfill the calling upon their lives. We are so grateful that you have sent them to us. Keep them safe. Keep their vehicles mechanically sound as they travel so many miles to minister to this community, to minister alongside of us, and to lead us into the next generation. We thank you, God. Now, God, we raise up our concerns, our needs. We lift up those that are in need to you, Lord. Thank you. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for being here in our presence. It's an honor to touch with God, to be in your presence. We stand in awe of you, Lord. In your name, amen. I would like you to turn into your Bibles to 1 John. 1 John, not the Gospel of John, but 1 John. It's more towards the back of your Bible. 1 John chapter 4. And Marcus is going to be reading, he's going to be reading 7 to 13 this morning. This is one of my more favorite chapters. I was sitting here thinking that I constantly tell you this is one of my favorite stories. This is one of my favorite chapters. You know, Philippians, the letters to the Philippian church is my favorite part of the Bible. I love that part of the Bible. But there's a lot of the Bible, and I'm beginning to think that I just like the entire Bible. And it's really cool. You know, I love studying the Bible. This morning in Christian education, I'm like, I didn't really read this psalm before and really understand it. Now that I studied it for Christian education, it's a really cool psalm. And then the neat thing was, I'm right. So if you want to learn about Psalm 73, please come to Christian Education. We had a very good discussion today. You never know what's going to come out of Pastor Raymond's mouth in Christian Education. It can be a little bit exciting. And please come and learn about God and learn about what the Bible and different things. So 1 John chapter 4, I really like this chapter. I really discovered this chapter in seminary or in college. Can't remember which one. No, it was in college. It was with Dr. Cuby, and a lot of us read this passage, this chapter, and some of the things in this chapter, and we were like, huh. We didn't, you know, come on. We're 18, 19, 20-year-olds, okay? We hadn't read through the whole Bible yet, and we're like, huh, isn't that interesting? We didn't know that was in there. And so it became one of my more favorite. I don't know. I like a lot of the stuff that are in the Bible. So anytime in the morning, on Sunday morning, when I say this is my favorite, it probably is at that time. So hey, get over it. So this morning, the month of June, I have decided to use the sermon series called Choose Love, and there's reasons for that, and I want us to really understand what love is. Problem with our society is that we don't understand what love is. We have this very powerful thing that has been built inside of us. It's part of who we are, and we don't really understand the concept of love. And that's one of the reasons why we come to church. That's the reason why we attend church. That's one of the reasons why we listen in church, and we need to learn. We need to really learn what it means to love. What it means to love people, what it means to love all people. This world has a crazy mixed up understanding of the Bible and love. And so this morning we're going to talk about the origins of love, where love came from, what it does to us, and how it's supposed to be expressed. And then later on we're going to talk about some other aspects of love. One thing we need to understand is that the world does not know anything about love. I don't want to be offensive this morning, but the concept that we have, the little phrase that popped up a few years ago, love is love, is not a good phrase. It does not conform to biblical standards or Jesus' teachings. And that's what I want to talk about this month, is this concept of love is love. Love is not love. God is love. And we'll see how the disciple, John's or Jesus's best friend, deals with this concept of love. When we understand the concept of love, it is then that we can see that this phrase, love is love, is not the love that Jesus intended for us to experience. You see, the central theme of the Bible, or the history of God's salvation, is love. That's the central purpose of the Bible, to teach us love. Love is the whole point. It centers around God's love for his creation. God's love is a salvation history of God's love for each of us. Love is the central theme of the cross. Love is what kept Jesus on the cross. The cross was designed to make a path to God's love. The cross was not designed to make us into good little boys and girls. It was designed to bring us back into God's love. This is sometimes, we have this understanding in our lives that if we don't get this understanding that the cross is centered around love and the Bible is centered around love, we will never get past the concept of an angry God. When we think of God as this person up there who wants to make us behave the right way, it is then that we will never get past who God is. And we'll always think that we serve an angry God just waiting to slap us upside the head and get us on the right track. That all these things that the Bible tells us, all these things that Jesus tells us, are designed to make us act right, be right. And that is not the purpose of the cross. If we have that idea that the cross was to make us into good little boys and girls, then we might as well continue with the Old Testament law and practice the whole Old Testament. We really did not need Jesus to die. Jesus died on a cross for a purpose, for a reason, to bring us back into a love relationship with Jesus. When we make the cross into something of a behavioral change, as a result, we attempt to design certain behaviors as sin and others as righteous. These are sinful behaviors and these are righteous behaviors. And all that God is wanting us to do, look, the gospel is very simple, okay? Jesus told us what the gospel was, real simple. And we have made the gospel into something very difficult. Jesus was very easy, easy about the understanding of the purpose in his life. And he, two sentences, okay, and we have taken these two sentences and really messed them up. And then we have listened to the world's concept of love, and we have tried to apply that, and we are all just one big mess. Jesus simply defined his purpose as what? Love the Lord God, love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. That's the whole point, love. The whole idea about all of this is love. It's not whether you're doing what's right and wrong. It's all about love. And when we learn more about love, then we're going to learn this month that the more love we have, then our lives will change because we are in love with Jesus. It's as simple as this. I love my wife. I do certain things to irritate her. My wife comes to me and says, "You irritate me." And I said, "That was my chosen calling." Now, I could do one of two things with her. When she says, "I don't like when you say or do or act that way," I could just forget what she said and continue to behave that I want. But out of my love for her, I make changes in order to make her a better person because I am in such deep love with her. So I make certain behavioral changes and do certain things because that's what love is. That is the reason why no other person will get, no other female will get in the way of my wife's love. Because my wife's love, that other relationship will harm this love. Okay? We'll talk about a little bit, that's what this whole month is going to be about, and we're going to be talking about that. When we look at the Bible as a book that shows us how to keep out of hell, we turn our relationship into behaviors and not the purpose for our existence. And the purpose of our existence is love. So if you got your Bible, we turn to John chapter 4. Marcus will read verses 7 through 13. It's time that we understand what true love is all about.
Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from
God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us his Spirit.
Let's start focusing on verse 8 in this passage of Scripture. It says, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Love was not awakened at the beginning of God's creation, okay? God was never created. God does not have a beginning nor an end. It has existed as long as God has existed forever. So I don't want everybody to can be confused how long God has existed, okay? When I said at the beginning of his creation, God has always existed forever. So if God is an eternal God, no beginning, no end, and John says that God is love, what does that mean? It does not mean that God created love when he created us. Love has existed as long as God has existed. Love did not come into this universe or come into existence when he called up Adam and Eve. Love existed long before Adam and Eve were born, and love will exist long after we are gone. Love has always been around. It is eternal. Love does not have a start, and love does not have an end. Humanity did not fall in love with God and then fall out of love with God. Love is always there. It has been around. God is love. Love is infinite. It's always been there. It has always existed. Long before humanity. Humanity did not define love. Who defines love? God defines love, because God is love. Every aspect of love is God. God's nature is love. God cannot do anything else but love. He does nothing else but love. Love is the driving force of God. It is the driving force of our universe. It is the center of our universe. There is nothing greater than love. Love is the purpose of our existence. Love is God. God is love. When you experience love, you experience God. You cannot take love out of God, and you cannot turn God in that he's a hateful, vengeful God. God only responds in love. This world was created out of the enormous love of God. You can get all the scientific study that you want. You can believe whatever way you want that the world was created. I really don't care. You can believe in evolution, cross-species evolution. I really don't care what you believe in. But the center force, when God said, let there be light, he is basically saying, let the love of God shine. Because God is love. The world was created out of love. Everything he does is out of love. Why do we have to get that across to us? Because we have this, oh, God is going to send me to hell if I don't behave type of thing. And that is false. Okay, it is true that that would happen, but the whole idea is that God is not up there in heaven saying, wow, I'm going to get Orville, who's sitting in the second pew, and I love him. We had a long discussion in Christian education about sitting up front, and all of a sudden, there's Orville. Hey, wow, Orville's really here. Yeah, I know, he didn't like it. So, anyways, God is love, and so he does not sit up there and have a list of things that he's going to do to each of us or a list of things that he's going to do when we misbehave. He loves everybody. When humanity entered into sin, God's love became distorted, and we no longer understood God's love. God is
love.
We have to understand that. He is not vengeful. He is not evil. He is not wicked. He is God. He is. And if you want to just say, what are the characteristics of God? Is
love.
When we remember that. God loves you. He loves me. He cannot. I want to really emphasize this because we really need to get through into our heads because of this world. God only responds out of love. Love. Period. God love. To help you understand why the central theme of the Bible is love, we have to look at verse 9. This is how God showed his love among us. So God loves his creation. This is how God is going to show his love among us. The word love is in the nominative case, which means that it is the subject of the center, the sentence. Every time, most of the time that the word love and God is put together, that love is the subject. God is going to show us this subject called love. He is going to share it with us. He is going to share it with everybody. If God is love and he wanted to show his love to us, then God is doing everything out of love. Then everything that God does in our lives is love, God love. There is no definition for God's love. We cannot define it. We cannot name it. We cannot claim it. God expresses his understanding of love, and the central theme is all about love. And then Jesus came and expressed love to all of us, and Paul then defined it more specifically. The focus of God is to show his love for us. John 3:16 says, "For God so the world." God loved the world. God's love is unlimited. God never, never withholds his love from people. God offers his love first and many times last. God loves all 8,112,930,000 people as of Friday at 4 o'clock. Because right now, 10 people just was born. God loves everyone no matter who, what, or how they are. God does not love Nazarenes more than Methodists. God does not love Christians more than Muslims. God does not love Democrats more than Republicans. God loves all people no matter the lifestyle they choose. He loves each and every one of us, period, end of story, no exception. And out of all of this love, he loves you and me. There is more to love's God than being infinite and unlimited. Let's look at verse 10. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. He sent his only Son into the world that he might live through him. Now, that has to be some shouting words. We need to get back to the old-time Nazarene thing when we hear that Jesus came into this world. He sent his one and only Son into this world for us, to bring us back to him. Those are some shouting words. And if we don't start shouting about Jesus and the salvation of Jesus, then you know what? I'm going to start bringing some rocks and trees in here. This is why I start lining them up all over the place, because if we do not shout out and proclaim the salvation of Jesus and the glory of God, then guess what it says? The rocks and trees will shout out. God tried so hard to be in relationship with his creation, but his purity does not allow it. The love of God is so beautiful, so pure, so wholesome, so perfect, that when God's pure love came to humanity, who is now sinful, we view that as God's wrath, because sin and God's pure and perfect love cannot coexist in our lives, in this world, ever. So in the Old Testament, when God came down to spend time and love his creation, guess what he found? Sin. The perfect love of God then wiped away the sin so he could have a relationship with them. What happened? The sin in humanity got wiped away. So did his creation. And then God could not have this love relationship because his creation no longer exists. So instead of wiping out his creation, he set up some rules and commands that if you behave certain ways, you can come into a relationship with God. And if you sacrifice and the lifeblood of a person or a thing is given, then that will soothe God's wrath, help him understand that it's covered the sin of the person, and then he can come into relationship with us. But that was two works righteousness. So what did he do? He gave his one and only Son. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through the Messiah, through Jesus, and have a relationship with God. And that's where salvation comes in. Salvation was granted to us to bring us back into a love relationship with God, not to keep us out of hell. And it's not about sharing the message of Jesus' salvation so that you can keep so-and-so. I don't want my neighbor to go to hell. I don't want this person to go to hell. It's not about that. It's about repenting and turning from our sins and coming into a love relationship with God in a way that it changes us from the inside out, deep down inside of us. This love is not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. It is a consuming love that has consumed our entire being. And when this love consumes us, then when we look at how we were loved by people who are sinful, who do not love us, oh, I love you, smack. That is not love. Oh, I love you, cheat. That is not love. Oh, I love you. Whatever evil thing that you can imagine done to somebody, blow them up, talk behind their backs, ridicule them, whatever you term a love, that is not love. And when we come into God's love and we come into his salvation and that sin is taken away, then we can experience God's pure, holy, perfect love, because love is not love, because love is impure. Because we are impure, and we cannot express true love to each other without the love of God in us through the salvation of Jesus Christ. God's love is in a consuming love, and it consumes our lives and takes over our lives. Then let's continue on. And we can see and when it consumes our lives, it is something that we experience. It becomes not something that we talk about. It's not something that we say. It's not just words. It's not just concepts. It becomes an experience that we cannot share with people because it's unshareable. We can't just, words are, I cannot express the love of God, so I do the best I can through human words. It's not about keeping people out of hell. It's about keeping people in a love relationship with Jesus so they can learn what it truly means to be love, an experience. It is a gift of God because love is from God. When God created us, he placed in us his image. He created us out of love and placed in his, he created us out of love and placed his love in us so that our main purpose is to love. How do you like that? He created us out of love and placed his love in us so that our main purpose in life is to love. God's main purpose is to love. He created us out of love, and he provided us a way back into his love so that we can experience God's love on this earth and in eternity. It is a gift that was given us that has been corrupted by us. John says in verse 7, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from who?
God.
Everyone who loves has been born of who?
God.
And knows who?
God.
God is?
Love.
That is the whole concept of love. It is being in a love relationship with God, and then through that love relationship, I am able to love my wife, my parents, my children, and even all of you. Thank you, Rich. That was so exciting. Woo! I got really wound up about that. I'm feeling that love, yes. Love comes from God. It's a part of being created in the image of love. Sin disrupted that image. Sin destroyed that image. And because of sin, we are now incapable of experiencing true love without the love of God in us, without the salvation of Jesus. So, for those who are a little confused and are like, I thought salvation was the main purpose of the Bible. It is to bring us into a love relationship with God, not to make us good little boys and girls. And out of that love relationship, then we love other people and we change our behaviors because of the awesome power of God's love, not because he commanded it. It is a part of who we are. The image is what makes us different from the rest of the biological animals of this world. God gave us this awesome gift of love, and we are the only ones who can express it. We were created to be in relationships. We were created to love. It's a center of our being. And why were we created to be in love? Because we are created in the image of God. And God in us means that we are to love. So every time you use the word God, you are also using the word
love.
Very good. So every time you use the word love, you're supposed to use the word
God.
And so when our love becomes defined by the world, it becomes corrupted. And so when we say the world love is love, that is not fair. God is the only one that is love. And it's only through God, it's only God who can teach us love through his son, Jesus Christ, because we were created to love and sin destroyed that understanding of love. Love is not a feeling, not necessarily a feeling. We experience love because we are in relationship with a person, place, or thing. I love people, I love the ocean, and I love my baseball cards. I hope that my love for these different things are not from the same source. The ability to love is from God. My ability to love baseball cards is from the world. Understand that. You love your house, that's a worldly love. Love only comes through God. The difference is the depth of interaction. We were created to have healthy God love, morally created in the image of God to have relationships with people. Let me repeat that. We were created to have healthy God's love, morally created in the image of God, relationships with people. It's only through God's love that we can have healthy relationships with people. We were not created to be loners. It is unhealthy to be a loner. We are created to experience the touch and love of other people as long as that touch and love is a God-centered touch and love. We are created to express love and experience love. God's love. When Jesus defeated death, the gap between God and humanity was closed, and we no longer have to fear God. Again, now we didn't read this verse, but verse 18 says, this is the verse where when we read this in one of our classes, okay, I was sitting in the row, I was sitting in the front row with another guy, okay, and he was next to me, and the three or four of us right down the row said, wow, it says, there is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. So, my friends, if you have to go home at night and you are fearful of your spouse, that is not love. If you are fearful of your boss, that is not love. If you are fearful of your children, that is not love. Love, there is no, absolutely none whatsoever fear of love. I do not have to fear God because I have the love of God in me. We have the love of God in us. We don't have to fear him. We don't have to worry about death. We don't have to worry about anything in our life because I am such a love relationship with God that I have this respect and awe for God that I am going to do what he wants to do because I live a fearless life because of the love that God has in me. There is no fear whatsoever in love. True, perfect, healthy, wholesome love. Sin in love is the reason why we have fear. So what we have taken is this beautiful concept of God's love, injected sin into it, and said sinful love is sinful love. And that is a true statement. But it's not love. It's sin. It is a feeling. It is a feeling within us that has no basis to it, but we think that is love. And when we truly experience the true love of God in our lives and is consumed by it, it drives out all fear. And then we know that, hey, I'm capable of loving. And I'm capable of being loved. And if you are not going to treat me with respect, you are not going to be around me. Because I respect myself, and I respect God because of the love that God has in me. I don't have to put up with people who are disrespectful to my God and to my being. I will still love you. If you call on me, hey, you have no idea. You have no idea how frustrating it is to be a pastor. We have people who says, I love you, pastor, yeah. And they go out and do whatever they want, or they do things against me. And you know who they call up? Hey, pastor. And you go over, and you lay hands on them, and you pray for them, and you love them. I have been doing it for 24 years because I want to make sure they understand what the true love of God is. love of God is an experience. Verse 13 says, this is how we know we live in him and he in us. He has given us his Spirit. When we allow the Spirit of God to consume our lives, to come into our lives and take over, and we are living by the Holy Spirit then recognizes those areas of our lives that aren't really loving and helps us remove them and wants us to remove them, because everything we want to do is to love God. I want to love God. I wake up in the morning, I want to love God. I see evil people advancing in this world, I want to love God. I see people, evil people attacking me, I want to love God. You spoke against me, I still love you, because all I want to do is love God with all my heart, my soul, mind, and strength. And when we get that concept of how our heart, soul, mind, and strength, everything in here, when I'm thinking about that evil thing that person did to me, I want to say, God, teach me to love them. God, teach me to love the world. God, teach me to love the person who disagrees with me. When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, it is then that we realize the unconditional love of Christ. Love is the Spirit in us, the Holy Spirit working in us, the Holy Spirit going through our entire life saying, hey, let's clean this room up a little bit. Hey, let's get rid of this garbage. Let's get rid of this junk. Let's learn to love people. Let's be free and get rid of the past and get rid of all this stuff and just love no matter what. Verse 12 says, no one has ever seen God. Get this. But if you love one another, God lives in us and his love made complete in us. When the Holy Spirit comes into our lives and teaches us how to love, then he makes us complete people. Because now we are not experiencing worldly love, we are experiencing godly love. And all of these moral things become, hey, that's okay. Should I do this? No, because I want to love God. I want to be a representative of God. I want to experience God's love. I may be hurting, but I want to experience him. I may be grieving, but I want to experience God's love. Because it's all about him, and he makes us complete. And the difference between a person who struggles with faith and a strong, faithful person is not that they are good Christians who have done everything right. It is the intensity of love they have for God. They have given their lives up for God, and they want to be in a love relationship with God, and they allow the Holy Spirit to come upon us and perfect our love. Now, our Church of the Nazarene gets a little slap in the face because we always talk about perfection. And God has taken some of those perfect people home, and I'm so blessed that God has taken some of the perfect people home. Because it's not about perfecting our morality or perfecting our relation or perfecting our morality or perfecting the things that we do. It is a perfection of love. When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, he begins to perfect the love that is in us. And now each day, each moment, we are learning more and more how to love, because get this, God's love is infinite. And guess what? If God's love is infinite and expanding, we don't know one bit about God's love. And every single day, we can learn about God's love, and we can become more in love with God and learn a deeper level of God. And all that junk that happens in our lives, guess what it's supposed to do? Teach us how to love God deeper. Everything we do is centered around expressing God's love that is in us. We want to learn to love more and more about God's love and how to share it. And then finally, John wraps this up in verse 21. He says, and he has given us this command. Anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. So we're supposed to love all people, not through worldly love, but through God's love. And when God's love is in us, then guess what we're doing? We're loving other people. Suddenly we look at people and want to express Christ's love to them. It's not about, hey, I want to keep you out of hell. It's about, hey, I want you to understand about Jesus. It's about going, you know, when someone's on the street corner and saying, repent or go to hell, turn or burn, okay? It's not about turning and burning. It's about turning towards Jesus so you can understand that wholesome, awesome love for Jesus, that you begin to come into a love relationship with Jesus, and it's about that love relationship with Jesus, and I don't want to do this, and I am consumed by it, but guess what? Guess what happens when we go into a love relationship with Jesus? We don't keep it to ourselves. We want everybody else to experience it. We want this outpouring of love in our lives, and we want it to pour out into the world, and we want the whole world to express it, no matter who they are, no matter what they are like. We want to express love and show them the love of Jesus. Everything we do is out of love. When we look at the news, we want to love people. When was the last time you saw something happening in the news and somebody's disgraced in the news and their name's plastered all over the news and you're like, oh, they just deserved what they got? When was the last time we prayed for them? We hurt for them. We grieve for them out of God's love. Understand, God's love grieved for the world, and understanding how bad it was that he sent his son to bring us back. That's why in Genesis 5 it says God was sorry that he created humanity. Not that, oh, I'm sorry, oh, I regret creating humanity. He was so hurt that humanity now has to go through this garbage of sin that he grieved. I wish I didn't create them, because I know what they are going to have to go through, because they won't listen and experience my love. And I used to think God was sorry. He was like, ah, I can't believe I did this. And now I realize that God was there looking at us and saying, I'm hurting for you because I love you, and you don't understand what you are doing. You see, it's all about love. It's about God's love. It's about understanding what God's love is and learning about God's love and coming into this sacred love with God. It's about choosing God. You see, God's love did not originate with this world. God's love has been around forever. And so this morning, what are you going to choose? Are you going to choose the world's love, or are you going to choose God's love? Let's pray. Lord, throughout these next weeks and days and all the stuff that we have to do, and bringing in a new children's minister and getting parsonage ready and rocks put down and weeds pulled and creating parties and all this stuff and doing all this stuff that we have to do with the end of school and graduation parties. We want your love to flood through our lives, to wipe out all of that junk and fill us with your love in such a mighty way that everything we do out of love. We get up in the morning and go to work because we want to love you. We come home to a family. We look forward to coming home to our family because we are so in love with them, because of the love that you have for us. Lord, fill this church and fill all the people, whether they are here physically or online, with your powerful love. And allow us to move in a powerful way through the love of Jesus. In your name, amen.
the Lord bless you and keep you in his steadfast love. May his love fill your hearts, guide your actions, and inspire your words. May you go forth in the love of Christ, sharing it freely with everyone that you may come across, so that the world may know the boundless love of our Savior. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Please stand and join me in singing the doxology. Enjoy this day God has created for you. Y'all are dismissed.